In this video, we're going to talk about non-covalent bonds. While covalent bonds are always formed by pairs of atoms sharing a pair of electrons between them, non-covalent bonds are based on the concept of electrical attractions. Non-covalent bonds link molecules together, while still allowing the molecules to be distinct molecules. We call these intermolecular forces. They can allow different molecules to be connected to each other. Turns out that non-covalent bonds are much weaker than covalent bonds. However, they are much more numerous than covalent bonds as well. As I had mentioned, these non-covalent bonds are based on electrical attraction. And again, that goes back to the concept that opposite electrical charges are attracted to each other. So we'll talk about two categories of non-covalent bonds, the first being hydrogen bonds. Now, hydrogen bonds are the attractions between the partial charges of two separate molecules, or two parts of a very large molecule. And this is specifically the attraction between molecules which have polar covalent bonds. Hydrogen bonds form between water molecules. For example, since water is a polar molecule, the attraction between two water molecules is called a hydrogen bond. Now, one thing that's so important to emphasize, the covalent bond between the oxygen and the hydrogen in a water molecule, this is not a hydrogen bond. This is a polar covalent bond. Instead, the hydrogen bonds are between two separate water molecules. Water is naturally found in three different physical states on the surface of our planet. Water can be found as a solid in the form of ice, a liquid in the form of liquid water, and also as a gas in the form of water vapor. Now, these three different phases, these three different states of water, are based on how the molecules within the water are interacting with each other. In liquid water, hydrogen bonds are constantly forming and breaking between the molecules as they move in a somewhat random pattern. As these hydrogen bonds are formed, the neighboring water molecules are pulling or holding on their neighbors. Yet, this is flexible, this is fluid. These hydrogen bonds can break, and the molecules in direct connection with each other can move to other parts of that liquid solution or of that liquid makeup. If those water molecules start moving faster and faster, they will get to a point where they're no longer able to form hydrogen bonds with their neighboring molecules, and instead will collide and bounce off their neighboring molecules as soon as they come in contact with each other. This is when water is in the vapor state. This is what happens during evaporation. If liquid water is warmed up, or if those individual molecules start moving faster, eventually they'll break free from their neighbors and become water vapor. On the other hand, if you're removing heat from liquid water, it will cause the molecules to move more and more slowly, and eventually those molecules will freeze, they'll lock into place and no longer be able to move. This locking in place of the hydrogen bonds is what causes freezing, or the conversion of liquid water into solid water, or ice. In this makeup, in this crystal lattice, the water molecules are actually held a bit farther apart from each other than they would be in liquid water. And this is actually the reason why ice, or solid water, is less dense than liquid water and will float. Because as those hydrogen bonds are locked into place, the water molecules are farther apart from each other. So solid water is less dense than liquid water. Now that we've talked about hydrogen bonds, the next type of bond I would like to discuss are ionic bonds. Now, ionic bonds are formed between two fully charged particles or atoms, meaning these atoms have a full positive charge or a full negative charge, and we call those atoms ions. Now, ions are formed by the transfer of electrons. In an ionic bond, there is no sharing of electrons, there's no pairs of electrons, but instead, if one atom has received an extra electron and another atom has lost an electron, due to the electrical charge difference, those two ions will be attracted to each other, and that is an ionic bond. Ionic bonds form between full positive and full negative charges. Ionic bonds are stronger than hydrogen bonds because the charge difference between the particles is greater. Yet both hydrogen and ionic bonds are far weaker than covalent bonds. Whether a covalent bond is polar or nonpolar, it is far stronger than any of the non-covalent bonds. Ions can range in size from a single atom to large molecules. Positively charged ions are referred to as cations, whereas negatively charged ions are anions. Cations will be attracted to anions regardless of where the transferred electron came from. Ionic substances, substances that are made of positively and negatively charged ions, they will readily dissolve in water. And the reason for this is because of water's polar nature. Because the polar covalent bonds that are present within water, there are partial positive and partial negative charges within the water molecules that will end up surrounding these electrically charged ions. The partial negatives of the oxygen will surround the positively charged ions, whereas the partial positives of the hydrogens will surround the negatively charged ions. And in this way, the individual ions in an ionic substance will be separated from each other and dissociated or dissolved within water. The last topic we'll discuss this chapter is the concept of chemical reactions and pH. Chemical reactions involve the breaking of old covalent bonds and the formation of new covalent bonds. During chemical reactions, no atoms are created or destroyed. They're simply rearranged. Into new molecules. Whenever we talk about chemical reactions, the molecules that we have before the chemical reactions take place are known as reactants. Whereas the molecules that are present after the chemical reaction has taken place are called products. While the products will be different molecules than the reactants were, they will have the same number of atoms of the same type in the products as you had in the reactants. So in a chemical reaction, atoms are not destroyed, atoms are not converted from one to the other, they're simply rearranged into new molecules. That is what a chemical reaction is. Now, the last topic to discuss in this chapter are acids and bases. Now, often when we think of acids, as they're referenced in pop culture, whether it's movies or comic books or magazines, it's usually some bubbling vat of corrosive material that someone or something is about to be pushed into. And while it's true that acids can be corrosive, what chemically defines an acid is that acids are molecules that release hydrogen protons when they're dissolved in water. You may notice I reference this hydrogen ion as a proton. Hydrogen has the atomic number of one, so it has one proton and one electron. If that hydrogen atom loses its electron, if it gets rid of that electron, all that will be left is a proton. So an H plus ion is really just a proton with no other electrons associated with it. The opposite of an acid is a base. Bases, they are molecules that accept hydrogen protons from a solution, or they release hydroxide ions, or OH negative ions. Now you may be wondering why accepting a hydrogen proton or releasing a hydroxide ion is considered to be equivalent. The reason for that is because hydrogen protons and hydroxide ions in an aqueous solution can be converted back into water, H2O. And so the net result of adding hydroxide ions to a solution is that it will remove the number of hydrogen protons, converting them back into water. One way which we measure acidity is known as the pH scale. And the pH scale is specifically a measure of the hydrogen proton concentration. Now, there are a few weird things about the pH scale. One, it's a scale that ranges from 0 to 14, with 7 right in the middle being considered a pH of neutral. Another interesting aspect of the pH scale is that it's an inverse scale. The more concentrated your hydrogen proton solution is, the more hydrogen protons you have, the lower the number on the pH scale, or the more acidic that solution is. Whereas if you have far fewer numbers of hydrogen protons in solution, then your pH will be larger. So, solutions which have a pH which are greater than or more than 7 are considered to be basic. Whereas solutions that have a pH lower than 7 are acidic. The last type of molecule that I'd like to discuss are buffers. Buffers can act as a weak acid or a weak base. They maintain pH within very narrow limits. Our cells will have buffers within them in order to maintain the pH. This is another aspect of homeostasis. Buffers act as a base when the pH is low and an acid when the pH is high.